Oreo, banana, or some other obnoxious metaphor that I haven't heard about yet. But have you heard these terms? That you're an Oreo if you're black on the outside but white on the inside, or banana if you're yellow on the outside and white on the inside. It's so frustrating. And yesterday my oldest son came home and said he'd been called an Oreo. And I asked him, do you know what that means? And he said, well, yeah, that means I'm black on the outside and white on the inside. And it sent me in a tailspin because I teach about this content and we've talked about it. And it's such a like a centering of whiteness, no pun intended, because white things are in the center of those. But this idea that if you don't fit some narrow stereotype that you're acting white, that if you speak proper English or like country music, that those are only things that white people can do. Or if you're successful or have some high status position, that you must be acting white. My oldest, who was explaining to me that the reason why he's an Oreo is because, well, dad's black, but mom, you're white because you're a professor and you're smart. And I was feeling like, do I laugh? Do I cry? Do I shake him? Do I walk up to the school and give the child who said this a piece of my mind? So I asked him, where were the first universities? And he replied, Africa. I said, yes. And if the first universities were in Africa, then the first professors were black. This myth that to be smart and to speak proper English is to be white or acting white is flat out wrong. White people don't own education. They don't own academic excellence. And who's to say speaking proper English is the only way to be? People can speak slang and be quite intelligent because there's lots of ways to be smart. Being book smart isn't the only way to be intelligent. I wanted him to see those comments for what they are. They're a myth, they're a lie. It's this idea that you can't step outside of the lines because if you do, you're acting white, as if blackness is only one thing and that if you don't toe the line, you're kicked out. I want him to buy into an idea of blackness that is full and vibrant and varied, unapologetic, that doesn't shrink and doesn't become narrow because someone's judging what they do or what they don't do. He wasn't buying it. But he did come back later that evening and say, Mom, I realize that that's really not true, and I just don't know how to deal with it when people say this at school. And so what I realized is that these conversations are ongoing. This feeling that, you know, you have the talk and you're sharing ideas about history and trying to like bolster their sense of pride around their blackness. And then these events and these things come in and kind of shake what you've been trying to teach them. And for those people who call other people Oreos, what do you really mean by that? Like, psychologically, what do you mean by that? Do you not love black people? Because when you call someone an Oreo, you're basically saying all black people should be the same. And that being black is synonymous with some narrow caricature. And people can't go outside of those lines. You're basically, I mean, you're being a hater. Like, let people be great. Why? Because they want to expand their horizons and do something outside of the stereotype, do you have to call them an Oreo? It doesn't make sense. Like doing something that doesn't toe the line of stereotypical blackness or that looks like acting white doesn't make a black person white just as much as Rachel Dolezal wearing box braids doesn't make her black. It just doesn't work that way. It basically means that we get to be defined only by the stereotypes, and that if we don't fit that we are white, which means like so much gets to be considered white. If we're really being real, like the travel and access to resources and education and all these things that whiteness has come to be synonymous with, we want everyone to have access to that, right? So by calling people an Oreo or calling people a banana, it's reducing them. It's minimizing who they are. So if you're a person of color calling other people that, you need to check yourself. You need to stop. You need to let people be great. Let them explore what they want to explore. Let them skydive and travel the world. And that doesn't equal being white. It only restricts, which is the definition of oppression. To restrict, oppress, to press, And so by doing that name calling, you're participating in oppression. And if you've been called Oreo, I'm here to tell you that you're enough, that you don't have to prove or put on anything to be black. In your essence, by simply breathing, that's who you are, that's what you are. It doesn't define you fully, but it defines you to the extent that you want to identify and explore the world. That's black. You're black. Or in the words of Viola Davis from The Help, you is kind, you is smart, and you is important. But really, seriously, I know what it feels like when people question, or I had somebody once say to me, oh, you're not like what other people said you are. And it was this idea that black people assume that I wasn't connected with or didn't love being black because I spoke a certain way. And white people, you know, assume that I wasn't black because I spoke a certain way. Reject the idea that blackness is narrow. Blackness is everything. Literally, if we take all the colors and mix it together, it's black. So if you have kids, keep the conversation going with them. You never know how they're making sense of things, so you got to be willing to ask.